And I'm Bill Huber, and Montero Water and Sanitary District Director.
Debbie Ruddock, SAM Director, and also Half Moon Bay City Councilwoman. And I'm taking over the City of Half Moon Bay as person on this committee.
Rick Close.
All right.
Rick's stepping down, I'm taking his place.
Oh, wow. He's busy with the new library.
He's busy.
All right, I'm Scott Boyd, I'm SAM Director, and sit on the Montero Water and Sanitary District Board.
I'm Bruce Russell, I'm from Ocean Colony Partners for Golf Courses.
Ashen Tadibadi from SAM.
I think we know.
Okay, spin the camera on yourself and...
Oh, I've already been on it.
Oh, no, I'm in the camera.
All right, well, we mentioned to the public, we have a comment, all business. We had minutes. Anybody have anything they want to change on the minutes?
I move we approve the minutes as presented.
A second.
I'm going to abstain since I was not here.
I'll second.
All right. If I hear no objection, let's just approve the minutes. Take a vote on that. SAM status update.
Ashen, you want to field this one?
Well, as we discussed in the last meeting, we've gone out for a, we went out for an RFP for the 25% design. We've received two proposals, and we are waiting for, we discussed this, sorry, we discussed this in the last board meeting with SAM directors, and direction was given that we wait until all the member agencies agree that they can move forward with the recycled water project. And so far, we've got approval from Granada and from Montara. Half Moon Bay is going to take it up in the next month's council meeting. So after which, we will take a decision to go ahead with the 25% design.
And one of the things we were thinking about doing was having the request for the contract for the 25% design on the March 28th meeting contingent on it, the project being approved by Half Moon Bay, so that we wouldn't have to wait all the way until the SAM April board meeting, that we could move forward if it's approved by Half Moon Bay at that point without having to wait another month to get SAM approval. So,
did you receive pricing on it?
Yes.
Oh, can we ask what the numbers
look like? Yeah, it's in the range of 180,000. So what, 181, 182, it's plus minus something. It's around that.
And both are pretty close?
Both are very close.
Yeah. Do you have a preference of?
Going by the lowest is actually SRT and RMC. Hmm. The second one is Kennedy Jenks and Adosense. These are the only two we had sent inquiries to.
Mm-hmm. How close are they?
I think about 3,000, 4,000. Yeah.
Wow. The proposal from SRT was a little bit more comprehensive, so staff had actually recommended to the board at the February meeting to go with SRT, but the board wanted us to bring back some more information. So that's what we're going to do next week, is to bring back that additional information, still with the recommendation for SRT, because the proposal was more comprehensive than the Kennedy Jenks was.
Yep. And was the lowest.
And it was a few thousand lower.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
So that's where we are at this point. Our hope is that we will get approval from the SAM board at next week's meeting, and then we'll just be waiting for the results of the Half Moon Bay City Council. I do know, and if Director Boyd would like to speak on this, that Montero's approval was contingent on all three of the members agreeing to the project. Did I get that correct?
Yeah, that's right.
I have not seen the video for Granada. It wasn't posted yet. I just know from Director Roman that it was approved. So I don't know if there were any contingencies. It does that. It's part of the filter system. Sorry,
it's running a lot longer than last time.
It's aging.
Do we know anybody here knows anything about plumbing?
I know about football. You know what a drop kick is?
So that's where we are with that. But our hope is that Half Moon Bay will approve it and we'll get to move it forward.
Yeah, it's great news.
I had a question about the proposals, Keishan. The proposers were just single firms, right? SRT? And I had the impression, the proposals themselves weren't in the staff report, but I had the impression it was just SRT without Hydroscience. And I know it was without RMC, and I know it was Hydroscience without Kennedy Jenks, because I talked to Kennedy Jenks and they weren't participating. So I'm just curious about.
No, I mean, it was not very clear. From SRT's point of view, they were very clear that it was with RMC.
With RMC,
In the spreadsheet that given RMC also. While with Hydroscience, they first replied back to us saying that it's same as the last time's proposal that we've sent you, and just take the cost from those. So I presume that they've got Kennedy Jenks.
Okay.
And then I started interacting with them, and I got some numbers from them. That's how we were able to, then they put it in the form of a table. But their first reply that they got back to me was saying that it's the same proposal as last time, you can just take a part of it. So I'm assuming that Kennedy Jenks is with them.
Okay. That was part of our discomfort with recommending it, was the dollars were very similar, but there was just less specification in there and less clarity on their part, and they didn't really add anything to it, so it just felt a little less comfortable than the SRT proposal.
Isn't there a current KJ study underway for CCWD?
Yes,
and we'll talk about the two technical memos we've gotten.
Segue for item C, right?
Yes, let's do it.
CCWD status update. Okay, well, let's see, we last met on February 8th, right? So since February 8th, there's a couple of things that I'd just like to report related to recycled water. On February 20th or 21st, a number of us, including Clemens, went and visited the Silicon Valley Advanced Water Purification plant down in San Jose, and actually, so we toured that place and actually got a chance to drink the water. That's Santa Clara Valley Water District's demonstration facility that's producing reverse osmosis water, but it's very clearly aimed at that we're going to do potable reuse in the future, so that's why you taste the water. And then Mary and I went last week to California Water Reuse meeting. I hadn't been to one in a few years, but it was pretty amazing. And what is most striking about the world of water reclamation at the moment is that everybody's attention has turned to potable reuse. And you know, I think that's significant for us, but literally almost all the sessions were about potable reuse. There are now about 10 indirect potable reuse projects operating in California, the biggest of which is the Orange County groundwater replenishment system. There are about 10 in operation, and there are about 17 that are somewhere in the pipeline. There's currently an expert panel convened by the governor of the legislature looking at the feasibility of direct potable reuse, and their draft report for public review is due by September. So, and then the final report by December.
So Dave, does that mean that they're shooting for a water standard that would not require the use of separate purple piping, and that it could be used for any purpose that a potable water is used for?
Well, there are various kinds of potable reuse, from the most indirect, which was with an environmental buffer. an environmental buffer, at least 2 months in the groundwater aquifer before it gets to the extraction well.
Right.
Then there's a reservoir augmentation, where you can put it in a reservoir. That's another form of environmental buffer. Taking it direct into the water treatment plant is another form. And then the ultimate is what they call flange to flange. That's discharging the advanced waste treatment product, we won't call it effluent, into directly into the potable water distribution system. That's still a ways off. One of the regulator from the state board who was there, Cindy Forbes, said, "I hope I'm dead and pushing up daisies by the time that happens, because you know they're just so uncomfortable with that flange to flange option." But I think it's drought that's driving a lot of this. There are also substantial economic drivers. And the push on the agency side is, the agency and the technical side is very, it's dramatic. And I think there's been a real turnaround in public attitude about recycled water. Nobody's talking about crap to tap or toilet to tap anymore. Recycled water, I mean, we have the technology to produce really high quality water, and I think people, and certainly in our industry, were confident, but I think the public is even more confident now as a result of the projects that are underway. So we heard about a lot of interesting projects. Some of the common themes are that these successful projects require really good interagency partnerships between water and sanitary. Groundwater replenishment system in Orange County is a long-term partnership between Orange County Sanitation and Orange County Water District. We learned about some really interesting projects, a number of which have aspects of what we're looking at here. We took a tour of the geysers in which is a Santa Rosa project. Mm-hmm. Santa Rosa and the agencies it serves with wastewater treatment were told they had to get out of the Russian River. That sounds familiar. Get out of the outfall theme, even though that's not really on the horizon at the moment. They spent $200 million to do reclamation and build a 41-mile pipeline all the way to the geyser power field up on the top of the mountain. It's easy to get rid of. During the summer, they have lots of good reuse on vineyards and things like that, so it's easy to get rid of water during the summer on golf courses and vineyards and things like that. It's during the winter that it's tough, and the advantage of the geyser is they can take 13 million gallons a day every day, and they need more. So that led to the 41-mile pipeline. It also led to $100 a month sewer fees in Santa Rosa, because Santa Rosa had to bear the cost of getting their effluent out of the Russian River. So you know, these are expensive projects. A lot of talk about decentralized facilities, scalping facilities for potable reuse. Sharon Heights Golf Course is doing this was an interesting example. Sharon Heights Golf Course has been kind of cut off by the city of Menlo Park, or they're charging them a lot of money. They want less expensive water. This is interesting. They are going to spend $17 million for a 400,000-gallon-a-day plant. Not much RO in it. It's a scalping plant. And one of the interesting things about that is that it's being done by the agency leader is West Bay Sanitary District. They have a delegated authority from the water retailer, which is the city of Menlo Park. I thought that was kind of interesting. They got 1% money, which is kind of cool for a private benefit project. And Kennedy Jenks said they might get a bit of a grant. Monterey has a really interesting project going that combines wastewater, stormwater, agricultural runoff, and the water that comes out of lettuce washing facilities in Salinas. They're putting all of that together, and they're creating. They're going to create potable water with it. And that will benefit those agencies down there that have been kicked out of the Carmel River, which is a huge crisis. It has been a huge water supply crisis for them. So I thought all that was really interesting. And we've been talking about, what are the objectives for this project, and how could we get more benefits? How could we get a water supply benefit? You know, we've been struggling with how do we make a project just for the golf course pencil out, but we've got 1 million gallons a day of water here that if it could somehow cross the barrier between wastewater and potable water would, you know, go from a value of negative, and this has been kind of the tradition, the recycled water tradition. We were getting rid of water by putting it on golf courses. Well, now we go from something that's basically negative to something that's worth $10,000 a million gallons. That's what CCWD will be paying for untreated San Francisco water within just the next few years. So, I mean, that's $10,000 a day. That dramatically changes. I mean, if we think about that, that dramatically changes the economics of the project. We go from struggling to pay $3 million to something that could easily finance $20 million worth of improvements. And we have, for kind of the future of the sewer authority's goals, we have a way to get rid of water 365 days, not just, I wouldn't say get rid of, but to use the water 365 days a year. And you start to think about, wow, that'd be really exciting from an environmental sustainability standpoint, from a, you know, kind of a local independence standpoint, to have that kind of water. And for CCWD, when you think, well, what would really excite the water district, having 1 million gallons a day of drought-proof supply, an absolutely drought-proof supply, would be priceless. So, I mean, that's the kind of thing that we started thinking about as we, you know, looked at all these different projects. So,
David, were there projects you looked at that involved recycled water being injected into aquifers and then pumped out through wells?
Oh yeah, yeah. They are in operation today. I mean, in some less regulated places, Texas, where the school children carry guns and stuff, they're already doing direct potable reuse, Big Spring, for example, out of water supply desperation. But so it's happening elsewhere. But yeah, as I said, there are 10 indirect potable reuse projects underway in California now, and 17 more. The State Water Resources Control Board has issued regulations that say, here's how you do it, and so they've specified the environmental buffer parameters. They've specified the water quality parameters.
That was one of the ones you referred to, is by sitting in an aquifer for a certain period of time.
Yes, and an example of that is the Orange County groundwater replenishment system. I think that's 100 million gallons a day. It's huge. So the water that they're injecting into the ground serves both as a saltwater intrusion barrier and as a source of groundwater for drinking water. I think that's a good example of something that could be done here. When we talk about, well, you know, we're worried about the sustainability of the groundwater wells that support the golf course, indirect potable reuse groundwater injection could keep those. You could continue to use that groundwater and reduce the amount of water extracted from the aquifer potentially. So, I mean, those are.
Does this water have to be treated once it's removed from the wells after it's sat?
Generally, I think it goes through a water treatment plant. Yeah. Uh-huh.
But is that a pretty minimal plant at that point?
I mean, yeah, it would be. Be
localized.
Like our treatment plant here, basic. Uh-huh. Basic uh-huh. plant. Yeah. So, a lot of exciting stuff. It's 5 years ago, I don't think anybody could have foreseen this. You know, one of the big topics is, well, is Purple Pipe dead? You know, does anybody want to do a Purple Pipe project anymore? Just because the water is so much more valuable and the price of Purple Pipe is high. So, you know, just thinking about that in the context of our efforts, I think, you know, that there would be a lot of exciting things, I think, about a project that had elements of that, as opposed to just golf course use. Golf course use could be part of it, but you know, I think could make us feel the prospect of getting something that valuable in the long run for everybody, really, would help us through these as we kind of agonize over, you know, the costs and the risks of this limited scope project.
Let me see if I understand this right in here. Water comes, recycled water comes out of this plant 365 days a year. It gets injected into the aquifer, you know, right across the stream here, right somewhere close by. It gets then pumped out with wells, from wells. It gets treated in some way, and then it gets put into potable water, existing water lines.
Right. And eventually,
all okay with the regulators? That's all been good to go.
It's all their standards for it today. So that pretty soon there'll be 27 of those projects in California.
How long has the Orange County project been in operation?
Well,
because that was one of the
when
first,
I was in when I was in grad school, I was supported on a stipend provided by Orange County Water District doing GC analysis of groundwater, and that was
years ago.
That was like
a year or two ago.
Yeah, a long time ago.
But they were one of the first that did that kind of project, right? So they've got a lot of data on how successful that was, and what the problems were with it, and water quality and stuff like that. So that you're saying we're not in a an unknown territory here, that the documentation has become increasingly good to substantiate the fact that you can do potable water.
The regulators are comfortable with it. There's been a huge amount of work on what happens in the environmental buffer, what happens in the ground, for instance, as this stuff travels through it. I mean, our analytical methods for trace organics are way better. The advanced oxidation processes, the membrane processes have come a long way. The advanced oxidation process they're using as a final treatment step have really helped with concerns about some of these trace organics because it destroys most of them. So I think our level of knowledge on the processes and the water quality has really advanced.
What level of tertiary treatment does a program like that require? Reverse osmosis or?
Yes, it'll be a microfiltration with, usually preceding the microfiltration, often there's nutrient removal. So you have although it's not necessarily are required, it makes the advanced processes cheaper. But generally, microfiltration, reverse osmosis, UV, and then advanced oxidation, which is, ozone, hydrogen peroxide, some additional oxidation step.
When you were at these conferences, was there any discussion of supplementing stream flows with recycled water? That's been a little controversial.
I think, directly supplementing stream flows is pretty uncommon. But I think in a lot of cases, these projects are driven by the need to avoid diversions from streams. The Russian River is partly that. All of the Carmel River concerns are about diversions. So In the sense that any water you don't take out because you've got another source is supplementing the stream, then yes. I mean, I think it's pretty hard. There's a lot of issues with putting wastewater into, well, say here in Pilarcitos Creek, in putting wastewater into Pilarcitos Creek just because, even if it weren't for any of the constituents of the wastewater, temperature. It's warmer water, so there's all kinds of issues, physical and chemical. that would, but for example, if you're talking about pillar cetos, if by putting water into the aquifer, which then flows out to the ocean, you can raise the hydraulic gradient within the aquifer, even though the aquifer is pretty well separated from the stream, that would tend to reduce the amount of flow out of the stream into the aquifer, just raising the hydraulic gradient.
Would the issue of putting recycled water directly to supplement stream flow be different than the issue of putting water that sat in an aquifer and for a period of time and then back into the stream? Maybe if you were to turn that into potable water, could it be used at that point for stream augmentation?
If you're going to, you mean if you pump it out?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I mean, I know the objections to using direct tertiary water in the streams, but we're now talking about
after an environmental buffer. You mean pumping water to augment stream flow?
Yeah.
Well, I think anytime you've got a supply of water, you can trade. So, another way of getting stream flow in pillar cetos is to trade with San Francisco to get more releases from pillar cetos reservoir. Right now they're committed to one CFS, you know. So I can't think of any instances where people are pumping water to put into the streams. More like avoiding the diversions with another supply. Anyway.
Something similar to, and you're talking about raising the gradient. You mentioned earlier injecting to keep salt water at bay. So it kind of works hand in hand. The water were to go in underneath, raises the gradient, and it would minimize the impacts of anything coming off the other side. And if the notion was kind of transferred across underneath, it's a different set of impacts. There's another environmental filtration process, if you will, that's available that some are doing, which is running water through marshes and letting, you know, the marsh biota take care of cleaning it. Cattails do a marvelous job, for example, with grape filters. There's a tiny little plant over in the Bayside in San Francisco, down near, I don't actually know what the name of the area, but it's like near a big concrete, the big giant piles of rocks and other things. Looks very industrial right up until you get to this little tiny pocket park, and they've got the bathrooms running through their own little pilot recycling facility, which is really the simplest. And I talked to them, was like, what are you doing about before you discharge? And like, well, we're discharging into a marsh. And the person running the place is an epidemiologist who felt very comfortable talking about this is a reasonable cleanup process. So one more thing to keep in the back of the mind, if we need just that one extra thing, and you know, there's a good chunk of land around here that some of it sitting here as a protection buffer between us and the rest of the community who bought this land specifically for that purpose. So if, for example, things were to go in at the top of the property and work their way down over time, if we put the right science into it and the right thought, we could probably come up with some pretty reasonable cleaning process to add to everything else that gets done.
Orange County has a lot of experience with created wetlands for treatment as well, and a lot of data.
Well, we'd like to have the water. Well, and I think
if the water's working its way towards you. At a million a day, but you know, it's not going to be 100% efficient, right? Because you'll have, you know, respiration all over. You know, you'll have all the different ways it gets lost, but you'll have, you know, we want to effectively free ourselves of the risk and burden of the outfall. We've got to take all the water and put it somewhere. So that fits really. Yeah.
No doubt.
No, I mean, and that's something that we've been every step of the way thinking about. How do we eventually get there? Because taking care of obviating that expense, the risk in that expense, frees us to do other things. So it makes some projects more feasible than they look like on their face if we're trying to straddle and do both, well, then it's just more expensive. But if we really are working towards obviating that outfall, then this is spending money to save money.
Well, the idea of taking recycled water, 1.25 million gallons a day, right, for the refuel, 365 days a year. I mean, the golf course needs, you know, big days, 600. You know, we have a water in need for 5 months in a normal year. I mean, doing something with the rest of that water, whether it's in the first phase, second phase, I don't think, you know, whether it's recharging an aquifer or restoring wetlands, I mean, there's a lot to go around here.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's 7 months a year in which we would not need water, even though we might be paying for the entire first phase in some way or most of it. That water, it'd be better for it not just be dumped. I mean, it'd be nice to find other really constructive uses for it that would produce savings, restore wetlands, I mean, create more emergency supply in the event of, you know, potable water shortages. I mean, it just seems like a really great possibility.
We need a way to pay for it. And
well, with all that money you're saving.
That's what we need to do. We need to have some, the benefit has to be tangible. I mean, I thinking about this, this is a unique situation here. I mean, this is pretty amazing, a pretty amazing group, really, of folks dedicated to thinking about this project. We, except for Granada not being here, I was thinking about this. You folks represent every water and sewer ratepayer on the coast. So, you know, this business of trying to kind of trade off risk, well, it's the sewer authority, no, it's the water district. I mean, we're talking about the same folks. So we really need to find some benefits for the community. And I think they're there. I mean, we have really kind of the textbook set of resources. Ocean outfall, not the least of which is having an ocean outfall to get rid of the residuals. Every time you treat water, you're going to create residuals. So a lot of places are really struggling with this. You can do RO, but then you've got a stream of brine you've got to dispose of. Maybe we could, you know, have them truck it over here. We could run it out in the ocean and charge them a bunch of money. But you know, we've got land, we have a treatment plant that's has a capacity of 4 MGD and is running at 1. I mean, there's got to be something we could do with that. I mean, we have a lot of resources. But I think, you know, I think what we what would really make this project go is envisioning a project going beyond this phase one that creates the kind of benefits that justify the costs and risks.
And so you're suggesting we expand our objectives?
Well, you know, the other thing is that we have 5 different entities here, and I think it would be good for all of us to say, well, what are our objectives? I'm really clear on what Bruce wants, what he needs. He's been very clear. He says, well, here's the amount of money I got to spend, and here's how much water I want, and here's the quality it needs to be. And the rest of us, I think, need to do something similar. I think we could specify, well, you know, here's what we want. We want a water supply benefit, and here's what that looks like. We'd like economic, you know, water supply will save us money. We'd like a drought-proof supply. We'd like a local supply. And I think this has the potential to satisfy all of that. But, you know, what's the benefit? Catherine Slater Carter said it one night here at the SAM meeting, what's in it for Monterra? And that's a good question. What's it? What is? Every one of these agencies will have to commit something and ask its customers to take some risk and raise some money. So what is it that, you know, what do we all want to get out of it? And how will the project that we put together ultimately meet those needs? I think that would be really, that would be a great thing for us all to understand. But
do you think that's a phased approach, or do you think all that's got to be resolved?
No, I mean, we could spend a long time trying to figure that out, I guess. I don't know. But I think it, I think kind of knowing where we want to go helps us decide how we do some of this. I mean, we have, the water district has invested a lot of money in water supply, I mean, as has Monterra. You know, and you invest that money with an expectation of producing a water supply benefit down the road, but that's never assured. But it still makes a lot of sense to do that. So anyway, that's enough for me. Sorry.
And the Kennedy Jenks study is.
I've got the district hired Kennedy Jenks to do, you know, basically to look at our what we thought of as our side of the project, which is transmission and distribution of the recycled water. And that resulted in Technical Memo 1 and Technical Memo 2. One was a study of golf course needs and water quality. I think we talked to everybody has that and we talked about it. Two is just a look at design considerations and potential costs for the distribution side, basically for getting the pipe across the creek and putting in, you know, what do we need? If Sam makes recycled water and of the given quality and quantity and makes it available to us at a pipe coming out the fence, what do we need to do and how much would it cost? So that's what this looks at. And I'll just highlight, so the facilities requirements are in Table 1 on page 3. A distribution pump station, a pipeline going across the creek, installed by horizontal directional drilling, and then whatever hardware it takes to connect to the existing OCP irrigation pipeline. They describe that. And then in Table 2 on page 6, they give estimates for capital and O&M costs. So not too expensive, with their contingencies, about $1.2 million is the estimate. And total annual O&M cost is about $36,000.
This includes the drilling?
Yes. So they updated the pipeline. That's the pipeline cost, $283,000. That seems to be fairly consistent with the bids we got for our crossing of Pilarcitos Creek in downtown Heckman Bay. So just taking these numbers, it seems like we would need about $100,000 a year for capital amortization and operation and maintenance.
David, did they look at costs for above ground crossing?
They didn't.
Like a trellis system or anything like that?
Yeah, that's, I can't imagine that would be less. This horizontal directional drilling, I may be, ask me again 2 weeks from now, I might be singing a different tune, but it's really very straightforward.
It's very easy to do.
Yeah.
The regulatory issues are not so good.
Well,
it's not the physical engineer.
Anything you do in the creek requires permitting by Fish and Wildlife, the Army Corps of Engineers, da da da. In downtown Hackman Bay, we're not even telling Fish and Wildlife. We're just going into the creek. We're not going anywhere near the riparian zone. We're totally out of the riparian zone. We're 20 feet under the bottom of the creek bed. So there really isn't any reason for us to, you know, consult with Fish and Wildlife. Similar approach to what we took on the El Granada pipeline. So building things, and putting up big foundations and stuff in the stream is, I would assume, would involve a lot more permitting. We have to get down in there with equipment and.
No, I was thinking of a span system. Not a very big pipe, not very heavy, yeah. Not carrying much water.
Yeah.
Span a long way.
Boy, this drilling just seems really easy.
Oh, drilling.
Yeah. So.
I mean, do you have any sense, either one of you looked at any trellis crossings in terms of, like, would that be a substantial cost differential, do you think?
Well, it depends on what's the riparian corridor and what the setback is.
Mm-hmm.
David didn't quite. I mean, you said you stayed out of the riparian area. I don't know whether you stayed back out of the riparian setback.
We're totally out of the setback. Out of the riparian zone, out of the setback, out of everything.
And it depends on what the span is here.
So we're doing.
Oh, I'm not advocating above ground. I was just wondering.
No, we actually. When we were looking at the downtown project, at the request of the board, we actually went back and really looked at, could we go above with our own, you know, structure. We looked at various, you know, the various kinds of support structures. You can get these things in prefab modules, basically. But when you, depending on what the span is between foundations, they can be really pretty big, even for whatever the pipe is, they have to support themselves. So it ends up being a pretty big and visible structure. And if you have to span a long ways between the foundations, it gets much more expensive. And it's a, you know, like anything else, it's something you've got to, when it's up there above the ground, you've got to maintain it. Mm-hmm. It's like, it'd be like the Pilarcitos Creek Bridge, you know, that only lasted 20 years because it needed a lot of maintenance. It's a very harsh environment. As I'm sure you experience all the time. Yeah.
In the WISIP project for the Hetch Hetchy retrofit, the earthquake retrofit, one of the biggest concerns was the rigid piping across the delta wasn't earthquake safe, because in an earthquake it could sever. And so they paid some consultants at Cornell University to design these flexible loop pipes on either side of the waterways, so that in an earthquake, the earthquake could actually shift 35 or 40 feet and there would still be enough flexible pipe to maintain that piping system, so that water didn't get dumped into the environment. So I don't know, I think these rigid crossings they're kind of risky, I think. The burrowing is a pretty amazing process.
Yeah, the horizontal drilling, we've done drilling long distances.
Yeah.
Small pipe, but long distances.
And this isn't that big of a pipe. I think the exciting aspect of the project in terms of design is, you know, it would be nice to be able to find out from the consulting design people what it would cost to add treatment to a higher level to the project, even though it, you know, may end up holding up the procedure a little bit. If we could actually find out a cost that allowed us to treat the water to a further stage, it may end up being one of the best things we could do for the community. We are drawing right now, the majority of our water comes from this side of the hill. It's really truthfully local water. Even though we're buying portions of it from San Francisco PUC, it comes out of Pilarcitos Lake, which is really essentially a coastside watershed. And so the idea of being 100% capable on this side of the hill would be a wonderful thing for the community going forward, I think. And, you know, always having the straw in the Hetchy, you know, system over at Crystal Springs, you know, gives us an amazing backup as a community also. So these are wonderful assets. But if we could actually figure out some way to be, you know, 100% local, 90% of the time or 100% of the time, the project really takes on a whole different air. And I think if the water could be treated to a point where it could be put into our system reasonably all this parallel plumbing expense. And, you know, getting pipelines approved on the coast has never been a very easy situation to pursue. And so the idea of getting a water treatment reality that's close to just being incorporated into the system, I think is highly desirable. It's expensive, but, you know, it's all the rage in California. So I think the attitude from, you know, people who might be willing to loan us money or might be willing to give us, grants or, abilities to work together as a community, and that's something that we've never really had before. You know, sharing an aquifer and having multiple jurisdictions means a lot of communication. And to see a joint water project like this, I think would be, you know, something really special. I think the County Board of Supervisors would get behind it. I mean, I think politically you could get a lot of motion on it. And so I just find that to be, you know, really exciting. And it broadens the scope of the project, but it would be nice if the design people could tell us, you know, what would be the additional costs or what other steps, or, you know, maybe this land that you have up here doesn't turn into a marsh, but maybe it's a small treatment plant that carries the treatment one stage further. I don't know. But I think it's just so exciting, and it's such a positive thing. And, if you also get water in the meantime, I think that's terrific. You know, you're a great catalyst in the process, but it just all of a sudden takes on a really special, I think, notion. It's exciting to consider.
Well, I think you raise a lot of important issues. I mean, the way the state's going, they're really focusing on local water supply. You know, the Sierra snowpack is getting dicier and dicier, and there'll be, you know, there's predicted radical changes after 2020. So it's near-term kind of stuff. And there's a bill that would take $250 million of state cap-and-trade auction revenue funds to provide grants for local water supply. That's a bill that was introduced recently, because they're looking more and more at the water-energy nexus. So not only do they want us to use less water and more local water, they want us to reduce the energy demands associated with providing water supply. You know, water supply and conveyance, it has a lot of greenhouse gas emissions associated with it. So I think we're thinking right, that, you know, trends are going in another direction, and they're going in another direction fairly rapidly. It looks like there's going to be, you know, some resources to help local communities. So I get your approach about looking, you know, potentially revisiting our objectives. I don't necessarily think that, you know, that doesn't mean we can't start with a small project. There are other trends on the coast side that may shape what we want to do eventually. The agricultural regimes, the current nurseries may change depending on what happens with the ballot box. Heavier water demands versus
we're hoping the water demand will go up, yes, for the new cash crop.
The new cash crop. You know, people are already starting to look at the nurseries. So there's a lot of things at play. It's just, how do we get moving?
One of the reasons that I advocated so hard at the Montero meeting last week to get the money approved to go ahead with the completion of the 25% design. I mean, first off, we asked about what are our goals. Montero has been clear for 10 years or more now that we want to do this. I've worn out my welcome with talking about what the benefits are over many years. So I'm not going to reiterate any of that. I fought hard last week to get us to approve this money and to provide incentive to our partners here at SAM to approve the money so that we can get in the cycle this year. First come, first serve on the grant applications. And we've already put a lot of money in. This year, another 100,000 or more already as a team here at SAM. This is the time, and we've got a customer identified. That customer needs water. we've got a project identified that I believe, I mean, I'm loving this number, and if some plan B on getting across the creek is even cheaper and you guys think, you know, wind up thinking that's a better idea, I mean, 1.2, I guess, if you round up, that's well under where I was afraid it might come in, and that's great.
There was talk of 2 to 3 million.
All right, and I, at times I heard 4, you know, so a 1.2 is like, cool, let's do this.
Right. Engineers were contractors, they'd run all the work.
Well, I've said it before, I'm just going to reiterate. Our project estimates at Montero and here at SAM have been dialed in pretty tight. What we're estimating, we're hitting or better. We've got projects in the ground, the one in Granada, in the ground, under budget, under schedule, with the fastest regulatory, cleanest regulatory I've ever seen. And we can do this by working together. Collecting our experiences, our know-how, the people we know, we can get these permits. We know how to talk to the regulators, especially if we all go unified. I'm not worried about that. What I am worried about is clock's running and we need to get things going. It's time to fish or cut bait. And that's the pressure I was getting from my fellow board members was, hey, all right, you know, Sam's driving. But if we don't have a way to get that water across the creek, then Sam's wasting time, money, and effort. And we don't want to be doing that, and we don't want to be doing anything that's got Ocean Calling Partners dangling on this, right? I think nobody could be more eloquent and clear about the need and the practical approach. Bruce has put in, I'm confident, more money than all of us put together in terms of getting to where I think he's one of the recognized experts on recycled water in our, you know, certainly in our area. This guy's ready. And
well,
so
you know,
we,
it's just.
I don't mean this.
I mean, I
speak to you, but I'm
no,
just,
no. I mean,
that's the sense
I mean,
of
we've been ready to go since 2008.
I know.
You know, and
I know.
You had to talk people into this. I had to talk people into spending, you know, twice what they're spending right now for water.
Yeah.
And then plus other expenses of maintaining the pipeline, creating storage on the 15th hole. We've looked, we're going to have to dredge those ponds. We can't hold the kind of water we need to hold, given the turnover rates. But this issue is so much more. I mean, there are other impacts that I hadn't even realized. Deborah's familiar with this. We have a horrible epidemic at the golf course in terms of the Monterey pines. They are dying at an increasing rate because of pitch cancer and beetle infestation. And it's now spread beyond the golf course, people's backyards, common areas. And in the last 3 or 4 months, I've spent an enormous amount of time with arborists, boring folks. But for years, we injected stuff, we used special fertilizers, we did all kinds of things, pruned them, you know, to try to cut out the bad areas. We have now been told that the drought contributed greatly to the rapid acceleration of this disease. I mean, we're losing 30 to 50 trees a year. And not to mention the cost of removing them at $7,000 a tree or more. And I didn't realize the impact of a lack of water until this last go-round when we all started talking to people about how come this is accelerating at such an enormous rate. I didn't even know that the drought, I mean, I thought about it. I mean, I thought, well, the plants need water, everything living needs water. But the lack of irrigation and the lack of water is really accelerated the problem. It's a minor point, but this is
one more thing.
It's just another thing that, I mean, we're 450 acres, you know, 1,300 trees. Be horrible to lose half those trees, not just from a golf standpoint, just from a community standpoint. They provide habitat, they provide all kinds of benefits. And the lack of water is really causing an enormous problem. So it's something I didn't even know until the last couple months in terms of how that's aggravating the problem. But I would really encourage people, I mean, David, you and I have talked, I mean, a long-term program of injecting, you know, the aquifer, utilizing our wells in some way through a leasing arrangement, as long as, you know, that's not going to upset people over understream drawing or anything like that. I mean, we'll work on all of that, but I would hate to see that cause this to be another 5 or 6 years versus now.
Yeah.
I mean, it would be nice to figure out a plan where people are committed to the next steps, because I'm in favor of that. Plus, I figure if you get saving all that money on Hetch Hetchy water, I'll get a better deal here. But you don't think so? But in any event, I mean, we'll talk about all that. But I'd hate to, you know, I mean, we've committed a lot of time and money. I'm sure all of you have. I think it's time to make some decisions here.
So when these numbers came in, where did you see this going? That this could be done the way it was envisioned, or that it has to have an auxiliary benefit in being potable water?
I think the if that's out ahead of us, then that should inform the agreements that we make. We would not like to build any barriers to doing that in the future, but I agree. I mean, I think if we could see this phase one in the context of that ultimate objective, that it makes it easier, I think, to sell, to take the risks, to spend the money.
And the way it stands now, it seems like that could segue from one to the other.
Well, I think, yeah, it's a longer process.
Right.
But
doing one does not preclude doing the other.
As long as we don't start out precluding that, you know, there's lots of issues we've got to deal with.
Okay.
To get that done, but I think that's what it's that kind of benefit that makes this project go. I still believe we've got a gap between what the golf course has put on the table and what this is really going to cost. If you look at these numbers, we'll need about, for our side of the deal, we're going to need $200,000 a year. So that's this $100,000 capital O&M and the offset of the lost overhead.
Yeah, I think that's an issue that's going to be talked about.
Yeah, well, I mean,
I don't think we're financing lost overhead.
No,
because of, you know, lack of selling potable water.
Well, somebody's got to finance it. It's either going to be our ratepayers or somebody else. So,
well, to Ken's question about, you know, I mean, RO on the end of this train, is it going to happen in the first phase? There's not the money to pay for it, given the economics of what we're looking at. I mean, if you really want the RO, I really want to know what the trellis carry, you know, the trellis crossing would cost. You know, what, but I'll tell you, I mean, to your comment about energy, there's no more energy intensive water processing treatment than RO, right? So, except maybe UV.
Although RO is not one standard, it depends on the quality of the water coming
but
in.
But I mean, here's the deal with RO. You're driving pumps, so very high pressures to push water through very tiny pores.
That's
and
right.
There's no getting around it. Right now, that's the current state of the art. For if you're going to do RO, you're going to run pumps, and it's going to take electricity. You can do a good chunk of solar, but that just drives up your capital, right? So, you know, that's not a phase one kind of thing. Now, the cool thing about what we're contemplating is something that if we decide that we need a completely different process train, or if we want to augment our process train, we're not, you know, what we're talking about here isn't about digging big holes and you know, pouring lots of concrete. This is stick another piece of process train onto the end of what you got, maybe pull in another box or retool the box you got, or you haul the box out that you got and haul in a new one. I mean, it ain't free, but it's very flexible. So if we can get to where we can get this first phase done and prove it out, get the experience, along the way, the technology continues to get a little better, continues to get a little cheaper, and as we get our experience, and we start to line up potential customers for this, as you guys sort out the economic model of, you got a lot of knobs you can play with here, right? So there's gonna be, as you lay out tonight, some of what you're thinking about, it's like, yeah, those things, looking at this as a supply, I mean, there's also the notion of when his demand goes down for potable, that increases. I think of it kind of like peaker plants. His 600,000 or so a day on peak demand day. Well, it's peak demand day. It's not just him. It's everybody.
Well, we don't buy 600,000.
Well, no, but if whatever you're freeing up from whatever instantaneous demand is putting on your system is
10 to 12 million gallons.
You know, that's stuff that you take. If you're producing it now and selling it to him, you can use it in other ways, or you don't have to produce it at all, or, you know, there's a variety of ways that pencils out, depending on which way you want to, you know, move the pieces on the board.
But I think what David's saying is that as long as we don't foreclose in the technology or the early stages, expansions to other things, that's why I recommended that we start out with microfiltration. I need to be able to say to you guys at some point it's not working, I need RO here, yeah. And we adjust the price and we, you know, add it to the system. But I think as long as we're not precluding expansion and other possibilities from the early steps, I think there's no reason not to move forward.
Right.
You know, the technology's expandable. Scott's right, it's only going to get cheaper and more efficient and better. I mean, compared to where we were in 2008 when we were looking at this stuff, the costs are much less than they were.
I don't think the suggestions...
Well, I wasn't saying anybody was saying let's put it all off for 5 more years.
No, I don't think the suggestion is to stall the decisions based on looking forward. I think the idea is that when we're working with the consulting engineers, and they're looking at the spaces and the configurations, that we don't preclude the ability to add some piece to the puzzle, or, you know, it gets located in a place that doesn't have space, or, you know, somehow it gets built too close to a property line, and, you know, now you want the big box in there, but there's no room to fit it, or it can't go there. Or, you know, we're going to bore under the creek. Is that the right size pipe? Should it be a little bit bigger while we're boring? Or, you know, I think it's these kinds of issues. It's not let's hit the brakes. It's just let's kind of keep our minds looking at a much bigger picture, because the idea of going to the big picture makes it a wonderful, you know, now we've got something that is a community benefit, which we don't really currently have. You're sort of a community benefit, but you're a private purchaser.
No, I understand
of a commodity.
That.
So, you know, what we're looking to do too is not to, you know, dress a wolf in sheep's clothing. That isn't the point. But the point is to say, well, this is just one little piece of the puzzle, but look at these ongoing benefits. So we can go to our customers and say, don't you want to participate in this type of an environmentally positive project? I think that's the point. And I think that, you know, my concern is just making sure that we're not, you know, running down the way to do this one little step, and then we go, oh, man, if we'd only thought of that. And now we're rebuilding stuff, you know, because we barely have the funds to do what we're going to do. We sure don't want to spend them twice, right? So that's the thinking I'm trying to suggest.
These numbers provided by Kennedy Jens are identical to the numbers which Sam's staff had estimated. I have the estimate cost right in front of me. The distribution cost pipeline from Sam RW facility to OCGC well field is $750,000 construction cost. And they've got a $745,000 construction cost.
So we save $5,000. What a great group. Well,
all engineers think alike.
Yeah, it's great. And if you're thinking that close, maybe they'd be the right engineers to work with on the project and the design.
So if I could sort of paraphrase what you said, make sure that I understand it, that you're saying that right now, with the way the numbers look, that we could proceed on this phase one, and that would work for you as long as in the process of doing the engineering on it, that we're all very careful to make sure that what we're doing now this works towards a bigger goal, which is phase two, which is to change that to potable water for other uses. Am I understanding this correctly?
I think that that those benefits make it easier to sell the cost and risk that phase one will involved.
Okay.
And so, I think it also gives you, you know, a much closer possibility for benefiting from it, because if the water could be treated to a higher level, it can be transferred your direction someday. Because I would assume that Montero has an interest in a local source of water that's sustainable and affordable also. So I think that, you know, that's just something to think about, so you don't have to consider how do we migrate that water around. How do we ship it or deliver it to other portions of the community? How does Granada get it, or, you know, the portion that we service might get it, but how would Montero get it?
Okay, that sort of thinking out loud and speaking only for myself here, that MWSD, you're proposing that phase two would allow us to have a larger supply of water.
Potentially, if you
okay.
need it or want it.
But the other way of looking at it is that if we can reduce our sewer costs, that is equally as valid, right?
I don't know about that.
Okay, so, you know, we're a member of SAM, okay? We get a billing from SAM. If SAM can reduce their overheads through the sale of water or something like this directly to you, then our costs go down, right?
It's possible.
Well, the recycled water, the laws enabling recycled water don't allow us to profit from the provisioning of recycled water, so.
But we're not saying profit, we're saying under right our costs.
Yeah, we can fancy talk it all we want, but it comes down to if it's subsidizing something else, then you're making up money out of something that's coming off of the water sales. That's going to be a subsidy. We've sat down, we've talked with council about this kind of thing, and recycled water law doesn't really contemplate doing much more than recovering your costs. If you can get O&M costs in there, you got to get that. Nobody's expecting you to do this at a loss, but you're not allowed to profit.
And administrative overhead for managing the program.
Sure.
So there is some cost reallocation that would occur, but it would be directly related to only that portion.
The cost that I would identify that we can and should go after is the cost that we're not really paying on eventually replacing that outfall. So I think there we can turn our savings in a different direction.
Right.
And I think that's a win for Montero. And all the numbers are saying. But it's but I don't think we can look at the revenue on the water as a direct source.
Okay, so basically that you're looking for the advantages of phase two, but also be looking at a worse advantage for FWSD in Granada.
Well, you're getting ready to spend money, right, on the design?
We've already spent a lot of money.
But I would assume that you'd want some benefit for that. I don't know.
Well, the benefit that we're looking for right now is to get this thing started this year.
Yeah.
We've got a lot in. We've got people who need it. I said I'd warn up my welcome on this, but it is in Montero and Moss Beach's interest to make sure that the economy, everything that we can do to help the economy at Half Moon Bay stay strong. There's no question that a healthy set of golf courses, in conjunction with what's going on at the Ritz, provides jobs, provides TOT, provides other benefits, you know, downtown merchants. It's good for Half Moon Bay. And so what's good for Half Moon Bay keeps Half Moon Bay a great working partner here at SAM. It's enlightened self-interest, but I mean, we're part of this community too, right? The community benefit is clear to me, absolutely crystal clear. We need to get going on this. And we're putting money on the table. Granada's putting money on the table. I trust Half Moon Bay is going to be right there along with. We've all been doing it. We've got a lot into this already, and I didn't ask that we had the aggregate number at hand for tonight's meeting, so I'm not going to put Beverly on the spot. But we actually have quite a bit in over the years on this. Mm-hmm. You know, the whole cost of that pilot plant, you know, it wasn't a lot, but it wasn't free either. And the best way for us to recover the money that we put in is spend a little bit more and drive this thing to completion, get the water flowing, and start recovering the investment that we've already put in. And we're happy to be doing that. I mean, I think Sam is really ready to do this. We need to know what the next steps are with our partners.
And also, Kishan and I have a meeting with the State Water Resources Control Board to talk about, obviously alone as assistance with this, but also the possibility of getting in the pipeline for any of the Prop 1A money or any other opportunities for recycled water on April 6th. So obviously we would like to go up there. We will be telling them that Montera and Granada have already taken a vote to support this project. We hope that on April 5th that the board meeting, the council meeting for Half Moon Bay, that they will also support it so that we can at least verbally report that the member agencies of SAM. I also spoke with RCD to talk about any possibility for partnering, and there are some possible partnering opportunities for grants having to do with the aquifer and the watershed. So certainly looking for whatever possibilities we have to try to defer the cost, at least at this stage of the project, by helping the water table. So without precluding the idea of phase two or whatever that might be going forward, but certainly looking for that. So Sam's very committed to putting staff time and energy. There's we don't quite track that as extra cost because staff were already involved in it, but certainly the commitment to exhausting all of the opportunities to partner locally as well as with the state and anybody else to try and move the project forward.
That's great. Well, I mean, we've committed funds as well. We've spent funds as well, and we see we're highly committed with our staff. And I mean, I can only speak for myself. I can't speak for five board members because we, you know, have to decide that as a group. But I think we're committed to the project, and I think we finally have something we can talk about. You know what the real costs are, the predicted costs, and we see the commitment on the part of the partners. And you know, in one of our meetings, you were discussing the complexity of the partners working together, and looks like you're past that. And so, I mean, I'm optimistic. I don't see any reason to wait, but I think that it's important to keep our options open. It's kind of like when we do a garden and people don't really want to run all the improvements at once, but we put all the utilities in the ground. And the nice thing about that is when we come back, things are in position and we can laminate onto that. And it's very convenient and it's been planned. And
well, that's conceptually what we want to do here.
Yeah, and so that's all.
So how can we get this thing going? We're supposed to have staff talking to staff about terms for an agreement, right?
Yes.
Where's a lead in to my stuff?
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh. I'm
yes,
sorry.
Bruce has to make his report.
Okay, I brought a big pile. Rick was kind enough, I missed the last meeting because of some medical issues, but Rick was kind enough a couple of weeks before that meeting to produce a bullet point outline of what might be in an agreement between CCWD and SAM. I have now produced a supplemental list of bullet points of what might be in an agreement between Ocean Colony and CCWD. I didn't repeat, some of these things are clearly similar, like quality. I mean, water quality is going to be in both agreements, but this is some supplemental issues. And we went through 12 agreements between golf courses and water districts and looked at all the ones we had in our possession. And we narrowed it down to one that I think is not the model of legal drafting, but it's pretty comprehensive. Some of it doesn't apply here. This is the agreement between the San Francisco PUC, the City of Daly City, the Olympic Club, Lake Merced in San Francisco. A very comprehensive agreement. And it's from 2002. I have phone calls into these folks to find out whether it's been supplemented or amended in some way. Since 2002, easy to find that from the San Francisco PUC, it'd be a public document. But I brought copies of this because this is pretty good. I mean, it deals with creating new wells on each golf course, storage facilities, things like that. I'm not sure, you know, the drafting is a little crude from a lawyer standpoint, but it's a pretty comprehensive agreement. It covers some issues that I would not have thought about before I, you know, we had these since 2008. But we went through our entire library of agreements that we had collected, and I think rather than run off 5, 6, 7, this one was pretty comprehensive, pretty close. Good enough for the San Francisco PUC and three major golf courses, I figured would be good enough for us. So I ran off copies of that. You can keep all these extra copies for members of the subcommittee that aren't here, like Rick. And I think, you know, looking at this agreement, it wouldn't be very difficult. Obviously, each one of these agreements is site-specific. Like here, they were building new wells, being new storage facilities, supplementing the water level at Lake Merced with recycled water. Pretty interesting. To restore its water level, if you're familiar with Lake Merced. But I think it's, you know, for us it would be, like I said, I think there are some clauses that could be drafted a little better, but it's pretty close to what would work for us. So I thought this would move things along here. We're ready to start talking about terms and agreements when anybody else is.
So are we?
Yeah, I mean.
Bruce, just for my curiosity, there was a recycled water agreement done up in Healdsburg relating to vineyards and stuff like that. Was that one of those 14 that you
No, they're all golf course agreements.
No.
We had the Pebble Beach agreement. We had three or four agreements up in the foothills, a couple from out of state. Some were way too, like the Pebble Beach agreement was like 150 pages long, which just seemed to me to be a bit much. But there's a lot of big wigs down there, so they're all arguing, paying for a lot of lawyers. This pretty simple. You know, there's a lot of things in here, like what happens if the federal and state regulations change 30 years from now? What's the deal? The deal is the parties meet and confer in good faith, try to resolve new standards for recycled water. I mean, you know, you could spin your wheels on stuff like that from a lawyer's standpoint for a long time.
Yeah.
You can't predict 30 years from now. You try to, but, you know, it's very difficult. So this is pretty, you know, if it was, you know, like I said, good enough for some pretty big wig golf courses and for, you know, this was a major facility. I like the pricing, about 50 bucks, 50 cents a unit. I'll sign up for that tomorrow morning. But they address things like what happens if, you know, costs go up in the future, what happens if there's problems with turf quality, unforeseen events, and you'll see in my list of things, you know, I didn't try to answer these questions, I simply stated the issues. You know, I think there are things unique to this situation that we'll have to address, that every situation is somewhat unique. For example, what happens if we're paying for most of the first phase, covering most of the interest costs or all of them, plus the capital retirement, and other users come online? I mean, we're going to expect a reduction in our costs. If other people want to use our pipeline, we're going to expect, you know, something for that. I mean, because I assume everybody's thinking that we will be able to retire the debt and the interest costs and the overhead with our payment. It might be a little short, might not be short. We'll all see that. But those kinds of things are, you know, kind of unique to us. Like if somebody, you get another user and they want to tap into our pipeline, and you can get them more recycled water than water we need, and you increase your production. It's only fair that somebody either take over some of that maintenance and repair of that pipeline, because I'm assuming that our participation is one of the things that we're going to be responsible for maintaining that pipeline and keeping it functioning right and cleaned out and all the rest of the stuff like that. So if all of a sudden somebody else is using that, it's only fair for them to pay for, you know, the water and our costs to go down a little bit. But, you know, the rest of it's, you know, we're going to have to figure out storage. I need to understand better when you're going to pump water, how much you're going to pump, what time of the day, as we get into the more details. Because we've looked at the ponds, all of our ponds, but we looked at the ponds where we would mostly hold this water. We talk about energy costs. If we have to pump water from the pond in which this water comes into to other ponds to store it, that's going to cost us a lot of money if we pump it, you know, all day long, all night long, to move the water back and around. It'd be really good if we could hold the water in the two ponds that where this water is coming to. But we'll have to dredge those ponds in order to do that. We don't have enough storage capacity right now in those two ponds. We have enough storage capacity, golf course wide, in our other ponds. We have done some work on whether, from a regulatory standpoint, it'd be better for us to dredge those ponds. They are not like some of the ponds. They have no reeds. They have no vegetation. Are they waters of the United States? Probably. So the Corps of Engineers will be interested. But or we could build a new reservoir. We've identified two places where we could, in Upland, build a reservoir that could hold 500,000 to 600,000 gallons. Tough to get there, get equipment in there, but we're looking at those things right now. We've hired engineers to take a harder look. We looked at this in 2008, our capacity to hold and things like that. But so I delivered the stuff. We're ready to go.
And we had talked about we were going to be holding off on sort of spending a lot of effort on the agreement until we had the 25% design. That was sort of where we had left the agreement between CCWD and SAM. But certainly, if you want us to jump back into that, then
what we're anticipating.
Look, when will that be done? Do you think?
Well, if it gets.
The 25% design.
Yeah, if we can move it forward as soon as Half Moon Bay, should they choose to approve it, then what was the time frame?
It was 12 weeks.
So that's just a price check, right? To see a 25%
12 weeks to complete it, but gradually they'll start getting
it. Just to dial it in, CCWD had expressly asked for this, so they could work this into their estimate of can they make a clean business go of this.
Right.
And so, it's just about dialing in the estimate.
Yeah. So certainly once we start moving forward with that, I think definitely at that point, CCWD and SAM should be working on that agreement.
So what I'd like to see, the agreement itself, most deals start out with a term sheet,
mm-hmm.
right? The term sheet's not lots of fancy language to, thicken it out into this kind of thing. The term sheet should be something that fits on a page of what do we really think the, first thing I did when I saw what Bruce gave us was I went to the table of contents. I looked at the list of interesting things there. And I'd like to see us go ahead and hammer out a basic term sheet and have that in our pocket so that when we get this 25% design in, getting a contract drafted is a straightforward exercise. I don't see any reason why we wouldn't do that if we're actually all on board trying to get this thing kicked off this year. If this is going to take 18, 20, 22 months, whatever, sooner is better on all of this. If we serialize all this stuff and wait until we do one thing before we start the next, we're going to turn this into twice or three times as long a project.
Yeah,
so I would really like the two teams to be meeting up and talking about, what needs to be in that contract.
Yeah, if you look at this agreement, I think, I guess parties and lawyers can argue about, arbitration if there's a dispute.
Yeah.
Fine. This agreement's fine with me. Whatever it says is fine with me. I don't think there's more than probably 5 to 10 issues that are not just legal boilerplate. I mean, we've told you the quantity, we've told you the quality we need. If you can't meet the, the sodium quality of the chloride because we don't go with RO at the beginning, then we've got to come up with another set of standards. I was really intrigued by all your field studies and things like that. At some point, I'd like to know whether you're going to be able to lower any of those, like rocket farms and stuff like that, because that would help a lot. Like, what quality are you?
Yeah, some of that's going to be policy questions.
Yeah, I understand that, but... But, we set forth the standards that we need that would obviously require RO at this point. If we can live with less standards, we got to come up with a new set of standards because there's got to be some gauge.
Mm-hmm.
But the point I was making is, if you look down this list of Rick's list and this list, if there's 5 to 10 things that people are going to sit down and, hammer out, I think that's a lot. The rest of it's pretty straightforward stuff. People, it's not reinventing the wheel. Plenty of agreements around where people have worked out, termination rights. They've worked out how to, deal with future cost increases, periodic reports. you know, when you guys tell us you've got a problem with water quality, you notify us right away, or you notify them, they notify us, so we can say, stop sending it to us, we'll do our wells for a while. But all this stuff, I don't think it's, you know, I guess lawyers could turn it into a big deal and a lot of money, but I don't think it's that difficult. I mean, it's not like this has all been done many, many times already. And I'm ready to start sitting down, and as soon as you get some numbers and we start putting numbers on what this might cost, that we start hammering out some of these issues. I think you're right. I don't think it needs to be a serial exercise.
We can, I think, some of this is
simultaneously.
Yeah, I mean, some of this is a spreadsheet.
Yeah.
With some of the numbers we already have.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, CCWD with the KJ report, we've got a number there. We've got, you know, the estimate that we've got in the current work in front of us, and then we can expect that to dial in tighter. But, you know, I think I suspect you're the one most motivated to model this out.
Well,
it seems like a fairly straightforward model.
Well, I think so. I mean, I think the more difficult problems for us is figuring out, you know, things like how to create storage. I mean, what's mm-hmm. the most cost-effective thing, because we're assuming we're paying for that. And so our issues are not particularly here. They're in other things that we're dealing with.
One of the things that could have a little impact on us, could have a lot of impact on us, is if you need substantial storage on this end.
No, I don't think we're going to need storage on this end.
So,
but I need to know when you can pump. When we move to the
right.
more detailed, I need to hear, I know when we irrigate. What I mean by this is if we hold in two ponds 500,000 gallons,
yeah.
and we need to empty that pond every night, and then bring it back up, we can't live with that, because golfers don't like playing golf with all mud, nor will the homeowners like it. We will have complaints out the wazoo. So I gotta figure out, I can bring the ponds down, bring them back, but I can't bring them to flat with mud flats out there every day and then bring them back every morning. I gotta figure out how that's gonna work.
Yeah.
And like I said, I can move water around, but then I have enormous energy bills, and that's not efficient.
Well, we all know that pumping late at night is the best deal if we can work that out.
Well, I understand that.
Right.
We irrigate, you know, at night.
Yeah.
But I got to have enough water
right.
by the time we start irrigating.
Yeah.
So I have to have, if you know, the replenishment, the time of pumping, mm-hmm. and things like that, I need to know more about as part of the storage plan. Because I need to know how deep I have to make these ponds and how wide.
Well, I hope that you guys are going
to
be able to start some of that conversation.
That out.
Yeah.
So, Deborah, do you have any sense about the where Half Moon Bay City Council is in this, as far as that funding, the 25%. Do you anticipate that will be an issue?
I don't, and I'll know more tomorrow.
Okay.
After meeting tonight.
All right. And then so that once we have that, then do you guys feel comfortable starting on the contract phase?
I think it's important, first of all, to present these numbers to our board.
Okay.
And have them jump on board.
Okay.
That's how it's going to go, and,
yeah.
and we'll find that out. And then, from my perspective, you know, I still think that it would be nice to have all the numbers so we could work the numbers, which is what we agreed to, I don't know, two meetings ago and last meeting. And
when you say all the numbers, what are you doing?
Well, the cost estimate, once we have 25% design, just to make sure we have enough money to finance the project. I mean, that's what we've been talking about since day one.
Right, but I mean, what we go to from where we are with current estimate to where we wind up at the 25% design point is having a greater confidence in that number. But
correct.
we've already got a rough number to work with.
Yeah, well, I guess it's just nice to have the engineers substantiate that. I mean, I feel a lot more confident about the number that we're going to spend based on the report from our engineer, which is why we hired them. So
no disagreement. It's just as we're trying to get things moving along. I mean, one of the things I would hope from our staff is that you could take this contract that Bruce has gotten to us, start picking out the items that seem like they would need to go in, so we could have kind of a similar sheet, so we can sit down with CCWD and maybe you guys would want to do.
Well, that's what Rick did.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is a user water district agreement. I think these two agreements are almost, I mean, they're piggyback each other. I mean,
yeah. And we have examples of agreements.
Yeah.
I think three or four example agreements that we can start looking at. Each one is slightly different because the end user was a little different. But
Well, it seems like then the goal would be to pick and choose the parts that we think belong in a contract that we participate in, so that we have something to bring to the table and say, look, you know, here's all the, chop it up in all the pieces, here's all the pieces, let's assemble this into something, and let's see if we have anything that we need to talk about how any of these pieces work. You know, this piece worked like this with Daly City, this piece worked like this, you know, down at, you know, somewhere else. And because I'd like us to be ready. I don't want us to be sitting around on any of this if there's something we could be doing now to prepare to make those conversations, you know, ready to go and kind of prefab. I think all the nitty-gritty detail of turning it into a contract, that's real work. But finding the basic terms that we need to be talking about, it's like, I love at the end of this thing, I saw the first thing about tertiary water and it just said Title 22. I'm like, wow, I didn't expect that at all. No, and then I turned to Appendix A or Exhibit A, and it's like, standard. Oh, there it is. Yeah. And I've seen all these same things from you. Yeah. And then it's just a matter of picking the limits and talking about things like this doesn't talk about how do you measure that. Is that an instantaneous sample out of a piece of the pipe, or is that
2002
average over how many gallons? Or, right. Yeah. I mean, we could talk about some methodology things to make it even better, but I think there's a lot to work with here.
Well, and Dave and I could certainly get together and put our heads together and come up with some framework, maybe. I guess a target would be good so I sort of know how to spend our time. Is this something that you'd like to see at the next meeting in April? Because that's kind of a short turnaround, or May?
I'm looking to hear things from CCWD that says, yes, we're going to try to drive this thing so we can get grant applications in this year. And right now I'm still uncertain where you are on that.
Yes, we're going to drive this thing so we can get grant applications in this year. And what we've been waiting for is this report, which we got. And originally when the new general manager was hired for a year for Sam, there was a concern about time. But I think now it sounds like it's become more of a priority, and it sounds like there's available time. And so what we'll do is try to establish working relationship with our general manager and your general manager and fire this thing up.
Yeah, I mean, Dave and I had several conversations, and so it was kind of the last meeting we had was we were kind of waiting to see where the 25% design was going to go. Now that seems to be moving along. As long as the city of Half Moon Bay agrees to it, then it can move along, and I think that definitely speeds things up a bit on our side because that's movement going forward. But obviously, if we don't have the city of Half Moon Bay, then that sort of puts it on hold until we can figure out what happens as far as Sam's
concerned. I think
the
indications are very positive. Let's stay in that frame and try to figure out next steps and anticipate how do we keep this thing moving. So city meets tomorrow. We'll know something more then. Is that right?
Yeah, we're having an internal meeting tomorrow morning.
And then you guys...
Well, it's, I don't know, what is it, 13th or 14th or something of April? I don't have a calendar. You know, second Tuesday is our board meeting, so we can present the information that we have and see what our board feels. And, you know, I haven't really heard any negativity from our board. We've just been kind of waiting for details.
So what would be the best outcome from that meeting in terms of what you might tell us that you're shooting
for? I think our best outcome would be, gosh, the numbers look great. I think we can move forward. It seems like there's going to be a reasonable budget, and so... You know, we're ready to energize, but I can't make that decision myself.
No, sure. No, I'm just trying to, as we imagine what success looks like. So we've got two different board meetings happening, one in a day, one in about 3 weeks.
Yes.
Well, our full council meeting is the 5th.
Okay. All right. So within 3 weeks, we should have the rest of the players ready to make some kind of statement, some kind of commitment.
And I think
we're asking our staff to help, you know, line things up from our side of things to have something to bring to the table for a term sheet discussion, and hopefully not long after that to get both sides to agree. I think for that we'd have to go back to our respective boards once staff to staff we've worked out some terms. Go back to the the boards, see if we get on the first shot an agreement on, okay, let's make a contract that says that, which sounds to me like two full board cycles before we can,
July,
best case.
July, you know, going forward.
Into June, I'm just thinking, you know.
Fireworks, you know.
Optimistically.
Blow some fireworks.
July 4th. So you said July. I think we could meet on July 4th. We could set that as a by July 4th. We'd like to have attorneys sitting down trying to get a contract underway and nailed down. Sound right? Then we've talked about now Beverly, you and Keishan are meeting with
the state.
The state lawyers was going to be
right.
Regarding the SRF application, which would also include a discussion regarding any potential grants through them.
So it sounds like you may have some information to share with SAM board and probably with everybody here about what that's sounding like sometime after that.
The April meeting, we would hope, because it's the second, normally it's the second Monday of the month for this meeting. And so potentially we would be able to have that, at least an update on how the conversation went. Certainly not a commitment from them, but how did the conversation go?
Yeah, so it seems like the next thing after that would be trying to figure out what forms to fill out. You know, what's the grant money to go after?
Right.
And so after your meeting, I guess that will give you some idea of we're going to want to line up on certain elements to be able to speak to that in a grant application.
I think a really positive step would be for anybody who has contact with Coastal Commission or people who might be reviewing this project, you know, it'd be really good to start talking the project up, you know, working the political side of the project, because I think that if we could get some support at that level or the, you know, Board of Supervisor level, would be a really positive thing. And it would certainly help in terms of the grant application process and, or, you know, loan process. I think it would be really good to work the political side, and that can happen any time as far as I'm concerned, especially, you know, talking about it as a community-wide effort, right? Which is essentially what it's going to be, Granada, Montara. And
I have a meeting with Senator Hill.
Nice.
Scheduled for this week.
Nice.
Just to sort of generally talk about what we're doing here on the coast side with regards to environmental issues, things like recycled water, wanting to encourage the both the federal and the state funding for the state revolving fund, because obviously that's passed through money from the federal level down to the state, and we want to make sure that they don't decide to do away with that funding before we can make the use of it. And just a general conversation as opposed to specifically for this project, but certainly to open the door for future conversations.
Yeah, I think it'd be really helpful.
And I have trying to get on the other Congress and supervisor level. It's kind of hard to catch them. Some of them are only around once a month or two.
Well,
so.
We do have their phone numbers.
No, I've already made the phone calls.
But you've got some colleagues here on your board
that
have some.
Oh, yes, most definitely. But I thought, you know, great segue, new person, new manager.
Yeah.
They always want to meet the new face, and then I can talk about how we're moving this project along. So.
Well, I like the idea of meeting with Coastal as well, and that's something that Debbie and I and I believe Rick have had some experience with. So that sounds like something I'd really like to move ahead on. It would be nice if we had a little more to say before we sit down with them. But I think this helps a lot, because this is an interesting part of it, and we can go in saying some positive things about this, get them thinking about, you know, visualizing this, and then that usually turns into they help find a way to make things go. And if there's something that we didn't anticipate that's going to be a sticking point, then my experience with them has been they'll mention it, and then they'll help us figure out, okay, how do we solve this within the regs.
I have one thing that I wanted to ask. I've been reading all of this pretty carefully and looking at our well results and things like that. As we work out a new quality standard for the water, it would
help me to know whether you think you can achieve more than you're doing now by addressing some of these locations that are problematic. Because we're going to, I mean, we gave you a standard that you're not going to be able to meet with microfiltration. Oh, that wasn't one of the things on the list, is converting from microfiltration, adding to RO. But rather than I just invent new standards, why don't you tell me how good you think you can do? And then we'll look at our, I'll talk to our, you know, consultants, our staff, and look at, talk to some other golf courses, and see whether, when you say to me, this is the best we're going to be able to do with microfiltration in these areas, given whatever internal changes you can make. I mean, Rocket Farms is off the charts here with some of this stuff. I assume you're going to maybe talk to them about some of this, but that's your business. But I need, rather than my invent new standard, why don't you tell me what's the best you can do,
yep,
what you think, okay? And then I'll go to my folks and say, can we live with this? Because that's, there are some things here that we couldn't live with right now. I mean, I know we couldn't live with
it. I think that, that would make a really good topic for our next internal recycle committee meeting. So we can hash out some of what conversations do we think we might need to have.
Yeah.
So I want to make sure we come at this as, some people could hear this discussion and get a little concerned about what it means for their operations.
No, I understand that. I'm not asking you to shut anybody down.
Oh, no. And I'm just suggesting to our group, I think it'd be good if we kind of took that offline and thought that through a little bit. Because we should be able to land on something and get you some idea of what to expect.
Yeah, maybe they can get rid of their stuff from their RO system somewhere else, and now they're flushing it down your lines. Or they can ship it somewhere.
Truck it. Sounds to me like you need about twice as much water as you think, though, if we're going to save your pine trees from the pitch pine gall.
I don't think so.
I think you're maybe underestimating your water needs.
No, we have a lot.
Oh, you're trying to peddle.
You're trying to sell you some more trees or something.
Yeah, I'm in the water business. You don't think
that? And the tree business.
That's right.
All right.
Well, you know, the good news about that is those trees, a majority of them were transplanted with a Vermeer Spademan at $25 a piece. Off of a tree farm in Higgins Canyon. I don't know if you know the history.
I don't know.
Of most of those pines.
Huh.
But it was so funny because you'd be driving on the highway and here'd come a pine tree on the front of a tractor.
Yeah.
And they'd stuff it in the ground or drive out on the fairway. So at least you didn't have to pay too much for them up front. You know?
No.
Yeah, kind of a bargain price.
It's a lot more to take them out.
Yeah,
grind them.
Isn't it wild what happens when you keep them healthy?
Yeah, well, it would have been nice for them to plant Monterey cypress instead of the pine.
Would have been helpful. And there are some better cypress varieties, too.
Yeah,
the Citriodora is really...
Yeah. Yeah, we've been replanting our replanting plan over the last 10 years. And it's been much more sophisticated than the earlier replanting plans.
But it's nice to watch them grow. But I still think they're going to need more water, too.
They need more water.
Yeah.
We're having trouble.
So let's see, we've got, all right, we talked about the framework, meeting schedule.
So then the second Monday of the month to avoid meetings and such, right?
But that
really second Tuesday.
Yeah, so why don't we push it to the third Monday?
The third Monday?
Can you guys do third Monday? That way it gives you guys a chance to have your meeting first.
I think so.
April 18th.
It's worked out pretty well so far.
April 18th?
Yes, 18th.
All right. That was too easy, so I'm going to run with it. Anyone got any objections to adjourning?
Well, wait. Before we do that, just confirming the agreement to alternate. This would be over at CCWD. And so just to confirm, so we didn't, because we got a little confused last time, you guys will officially take notes, minutes for that one?
Oh, is the next one at CCWD?
Yeah, we're wanting it to be a...
As long as you guys are all right with that. You guys
we just wanted to confirm, because last time there was some confusion as to...
iPhones, which I appreciate.
Well, I'm just trying to capture a date for you. Are you interested in the date? Or?
Sorry, Ken.
All right, so next time CCWD
you work
on
for
the
Apple,
18th,
so I know you're excited.
You guys will take care of the
but
minutes.
You think it's better to get a small one than a big one?
Now we're done.
All right.
I can't read this.
I don't hear any objections, so I think we're adjourned.
Look at that.
Thank you, everybody.
And thank you.